Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions About Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week, it's part two of our Jean Arthur Acteurist Oeuvre-view. We'll be getting into 1935, looking at a couple of films that were helpful in moving our actor's career along, The Whole Town's Talking, and Party Wire. At the end of the show, we'll have our Fear and Movie Going in Toronto segment. We'll be talking about The Red Detachment of Women, a Maoist film from 1961.
Agitprop.
So you won't want to miss that.
First North American screening.
At least for the restoration. All right, Elise. Well, let's start talking about The Whole Town's Talking. This is directed by John Ford.
So you've seen this. I've seen this before, too. But, like, I didn't remember anything about it. It was so long. And you've seen this before. And you did remember not being that enthused about it. How did you feel this time?
About the same. There's a lot to talk about here, and I think it's an interesting movie in many ways, but it does sit strangely alongside a lot of the other stuff that Columbia was doing. This was the year after the Capra-sance, right? Like the Frank Capra explosion. He won all the Oscars, and that was a big deal. It put Columbia on the map for real, and that was all for It Happened One Night. Everyone was starting to pay more attention to this little upstart studio, and they were obviously making a name for themselves as the romantic comedy slash screwball studio. Here they get John Ford, a big director.
Right around this time is doing a lot of work with Will Rogers.
Very different kind of comedy, yeah. Mm-hmm. They get Edward G. Robinson, a big star from Warner Brothers.
And yeah, and I mean, in terms of Jean Arthur's career, obviously contrasting to the first episode, these are A pictures.
Oh yeah, definitely. And this one particularly, and she is second billed, right? She's not above the title. It's Edward G. Robinson with Jean Arthur. I think that's the last time she's going to be billed in that way. As much as I have come around to a lot of the Ford films we've been watching, here I did still feel kind of similarly, that he's not right for this material.
I don't know. Should some of the blame go to the screenplay by Joe Swerling and Robert Riskin, frequent Capra collaborators?
Yeah, exactly. These are primary Capra collaborators. I think a lot of it just has to do with the fact that when Frank Capra got a hold of their scripts, he contributed and he did something different with them. This just feels like an alien tried to make a Frank Capra movie, doesn't it?
I don't know about that. This movie doesn't scream Frank Capra to me.
Well, it's got all the elements, but it does not go in a Capra-esque direction in any way.
I just feel like the screenplay is a mess.
Well, it is.
It has no shape to it at all. It starts out as a comedy and is succeeding at that and then becomes a pointless melodrama, the only point of which seems to be this tour de force Edward G. Robinson performance, which, I mean, would be fun at the time to go to a movie and see this, but does limited amounts of things for me now. And sometimes I have this problem with Olivia de Havilland performances, because when you split him up into his two character types, neither one of them in themselves is very interesting. What I mean is that when you split them up and make them into this contrasting caricature, they're not very interesting.
Well, sure, of course, because
he's not allowed to have any layers of complexity.
No. When you give him a whole movie to develop a character, he can go anywhere on the spectrum between these two poles.
Right, and here he's just supposed to be all meek and all bully the whole time.
Yeah, an interesting exercise for him, I'm sure, and it did do well at the box office, but almost any Edward G. Robinson film is going to to be more rewarding for him than this.
This seemed to do well for everyone's careers. It did well for Columbia. It did well for him. I'm sure it did well for Jean Arthur, despite the smallness, the slightness of her role here.
Yeah, so let's talk about how the film handles her. It does start out seeming like it's going to be a tremendous role for her, but it really reaches its height when she's being interrogated by the police and then just goes nowhere from there.
That was hilarious. Well, no, let's talk about the movie a little more first, I think.
Of course.
So, I mean, I think part of the problem is that your expectations are set so high from the fact that not only are there these wonderful stars, wonderful screenwriters, wonderful director.
Great character actors.
That's what I'm saying. Also, everywhere you turn, there are incredible character actors in this movie. In the comic first half, everybody is just doing their thing.
Yeah, Etienne Giraldot gets a nice big role here as the office manager. He's wonderful.
And it's just snap, crackle, pop. Everywhere you turn, somebody's doing their comic bit. Still, it's not really crackling like it should be, though.
Again, that's not John Ford's thing.
There's not momentum. There should be Sturges-type momentum. Or yeah, even Capra-type momentum from, say, Mr. Smith or something like that. The way it starts out, it seems like it's going to be an after-hours type of movie. Right? A scapegoat comedy about this meek clerk. We don't even find out what he's a clerk of. Just being tortured by this weird Twilight Zone coincidence. That has possibilities. Once the police get hold of him, it becomes even more Kafkaesque. They're all absurdly incompetent and aren't observing any kind of due process.
No.
And so the chaos and the scapegoating theme, yeah, really reach their apex there. But after that, it's just performing different variations on what could happen with this scenario. And yeah, ultimately, Jean Arthur's character is lost completely. And that's very weird because even in basic dramatic structure, you'd think they would be cutting back and forth between her. Like something really went wrong with this screenplay or with the final cut of the film or something. You'd think they would be cutting back and forth between her being held prisoner and whatever other plots are going on, the Edward G. Robinson plot. Also, this aunt is never even seen before the rescue scene.
No, she's just referred to. So
she's like, she shouldn't even be in the screenplay at all, right? She's just useless. She's just like a duplicate of what's happening to Jean Arthur. It doesn't make any sense. Something's gone wrong here.
I agree. I don't feel like it's a very successful movie, despite having some glittering little moments in it. Interrogation scene where she just blames Killer Mannion for every crime that's been committed in the past 5 years in America, basically. Having a wonderful time with the police. She's just completely unflappable.
Yeah, well, okay, let's talk about this character before we talk a little bit more about her character, before we talk a little bit more about the movie. I'm going back and forth on what I want to talk about here. So when she first appears on the screen, we get this setup where Edward G. Robinson has worked for 8 years for this company, is the only employee who has never been late.
Now he's another model milquetoast employee, which is the kind of thing he will do in Scarlet Street, for instance.
Right, and so far in his filmography, I'm not terribly familiar with his early filmography.
Well, he's been a gangster almost exclusively.
Almost every time, but he was a patsy in Tiger Shark, so that's maybe the only time he's done something like this that I'm aware of.
Yeah, but it's definitely not the same kind of patsy, not someone who names his pets Abelard and Eloise.
That almost seems like somebody watched Le Chien, Renoir's Le Chien, copied that character. I can't remember the year of that, though.
Well, that's 1931, I think.
Oh, well, I'm sure it's just a coincidence. He's a tiny bit Monsieur Lange-like, too.
For sure.
This guy's straight out of Renoir, at any rate, by coincidence or design. Who knows what Joe Swirling and Robert Riskin were watching?
Well, he's straight out of a million movies about a meek guy who stalks a woman and gets rewarded for it.
Which is also very after hours. He doesn't get rewarded for it, though.
not that guy. Well, he gets what he deserves.
he gets more than he deserves, really.
Yeah.
Punishment outweighs the crime. But yeah, I mean, I guess then it's likely that the other half of Edward G. Robinson's career is born with this movie. This is a type of character that he'll return to.
Sure. And Robinson is great in comedies, but I don't feel like this is the best use of his talents. You know, something like A Slight Case of Murder or Brother Orchid works a lot better. I mean, he's playing a more nuanced criminal type who gets involved in comedic hijinks. I do like your idea that the isolation of two extremes of Robinson's personae cancel each other out.
Yeah, it makes each of them less interesting, because obviously what's interesting about the Scarlet Street character, for example, is that he is this meek guy, but he turns out to be capable of terrible violence and...
anger.
Violence and anger. This character, too, turns out to be capable of violence, but...
well, it's almost accidental, though.
It's a very perfunctory worm turn. It's not even as good a worm turn as one of those Tashlin, Jerry Lewis movies, where the whole movie has been geared towards making this happen.
It's just an accident. He comes home a couple minutes before his counterpart, realizes that he's got to order the henchman to kill Mannion, and does it. But he doesn't do it in a really authoritative way or anything. He doesn't become a different kind of person, which in a way is good, because every time I watch this, I saw it a couple of times in the 90s, and I was like, no, I'm done with this. It does seem like the movie is pushing for him to really shed all of his meek characteristics and become a he-man, and it doesn't actually do that, despite the fact that Jean Arthur talks a lot about how he's got to make those changes before he can become viable.
Well, it's extremely unclear, and this is part of the problem with her underwritten character.
Yeah.
It's extremely unclear what she actually wants him to be.
That's right.
So that's another nascent sort of Jerry Lewis thing, like the Nutty Professor, but that's more of the point of the movie, that Stella isn't sure which one she wants him to be and would kind of like him to be, maybe just alternate. Just have a bit of serum in your back pocket and alternate, right? So you can see a meek character comic archetype standing behind this movie, for sure, just not being used that effectively.
And none of the values he stands for have any impact or meaning to anyone else, right? That's a huge difference from what Capra would do. He would ennoble everyone around him with his...
or Renoir with Monsieur Lange.
Yes, Renoir would do it with much more tongue-in-cheek than Capra, but it would be, in a sense, the same effect. This totally alien, benign figure
and dreamer
has an effect on the people around him. That's what Jean Arthur does in Capra films more than anything. She is a woman who has made concessions to the modern world, and she's a little bit unhappy about that, but she's also very successful. This person comes along that causes her to rethink some things without completely going over to their side. Basically, she becomes rebalanced through an encounter with this man-child and helps to pull them into the adult world.
Yeah, which is done differently by the female protagonist in The Crime de Monsieur Lange.
Yeah, well, she just does it kind of unilaterally, right? In the Capra movies, it's a little bit more of a give and take.
Well, here the Arthur character is, you can see that, is nascent here, that she tries to start doing that unilaterally, making him accept money for his writing and things like that. That's kind of almost the last we see of her. Just disappears, and then the movie turns into this, like, dead ringers thing with the relationship between the two Edward G. Robinsons. I mean, that's one of the reasons to me that the second half of the movie feels so bleak, and it's, I guess it's related to Jean Arthur disappearing, because it never becomes clear that this clerk, this meek clerk, who is, until the end, uniformly meek in his relations with Mannion, that he stands for anything. Like, he might as well be the Scarlet Street character. He might as well just be a pathetic jellyfish. And also, the screenplay goes backwards on this, because we saw him develop in the completely hilarious drunk scene with his boss, the owner of whatever this company is that he works for, the newspaper guy who wants to use his name for the stories about Mannion. It was a very funny drunk scene, and he comes out of that himself transformed a little bit, and then you think, okay, well, this character, we don't know what he's going to progress into, but he is going to progress.
But he doesn't,
because then Mannion shows up, and then he just, like, the two characters just split into these two uninteresting halves by themselves, right?
Yeah.
And it just becomes a second movie.
And it really gets dangerous at certain points. People get killed in this movie, which you're not really going to see too often in a Capra romantic comedy. You certainly see it in some Capra contexts. Bitter Tea of General Yen, life and death stakes there. But when Capra does his Jean Arthur movies, there's no machine gun involved.
Well, interestingly, the writer of the story that this was based on also wrote the novel Little Caesar.
Yeah, right. Burnett.
Yeah. One of the things the movie is doing, clearly, is doing some kind of meta joke parody of Little Caesar. But then for some, I don't know why, reason, the movie decides that it actually needs to turn into Little Caesar at certain points.
Yeah.
Which I don't agree.
Pretty interesting, right? Because... Like, think about how this lines up with a movie like Ball of Fire, where there are stakes, there's some danger there, but the gangsters are really quite hilarious as well. You got Pastrami, Dan Duryea, and Dana Andrews is playing a pretty dangerous crime lord, but his name is Joe Lilac, and he's got his special pajamas.
Well, there's definitely some violence threatened against Barbara Stanwyck.
Well, there is, but I'm just saying it's also pretty comedic all the way through, and there's a stylized aspect to it, and here, not so much. These gangsters are like in a gangster movie.
Yeah, so I feel where it goes off the rails is that somebody decided that what the audience was really going to want to see was Edward G. Robinson play against each other. Because really, this gangster should, as far as the screenplay goes that we initially see, this gangster should have just showed up very briefly and been a little menacing in the background, and otherwise the plot of mistaken identity and nebbish evolution and relationship could have continued.
Yeah, well, I guess maybe this is one of those areas or one of those instances where the logic of the plot overwhelmed the artistic intentions. Because obviously, if you have a guy like Mannion who finds out that there's a passport to do whatever you want in the city available, he is going to get his hands on it and use it for nefarious purposes. But it doesn't make a very interesting movie to see that. I mean, he goes behind bars to kill Edward Brophy and does. And that is a really disturbing scene. I mean, he just walks down the hallway, comes back, and wipes his hands clean of the murdered man's DNA, I guess. I don't know what he did to him. And it's quite stylishly shot. It's William August, of course, the cinematographer who brought us many great films, including his final masterpiece, Portrait of Jenny.
I mean, yeah, the movie looked gorgeous. Something I found out in the research that was interesting. So, of course, the Cahiers and other French theorists who adored Ford, of course, they had many complimentary things to say about this movie. There's a quote from film critic and historian Jean Mitry, who says that the film is wonderfully cut and mounted, supercharged, taut like a spring. It is a work of total perfection in its genre. Okay, A, no, and B, what is its genre?
Yeah, that's a good question.
Oh, and Michael Costello of All Movie Guide, there's also a quote from him. Ford directs and cuts the scenes with uncharacteristic rapidity, seeming to enjoy playing off the meat clerk against the anarchic gangster. Okay, so here, auteurism is going too far, because this is a studio film. John Ford is not that big a deal yet, and there is an editor on this film who was the head of editing at Columbia, who is Viola Lawrence. So if this editing is uncharacteristic, that might be the reason why. So again, Harry Cohn promoting women left and right like no other studio was doing. Viola Lawrence apparently was the first female Hollywood film editor. I think I have read that that is the case. If anyone listening knows differently, please advise us. So yes, so she became Columbia's head editor or supervising editor in 1925.
Okay.
And then we've also mentioned screenwriter Dorothy Howell, started as Cohn's secretary and became assistant general production manager in 1926. And of course, later, screenwriter Virginia Van Upp would become one of the very few female producers and probably the only one who didn't have some other important connection that helped her in her ascendancy. The other ones being Harriet Parsons, who had a famous mother, and Joan Harrison, who got her start with Hitchcock.
Famous Hitchcock.
A famous Hitchcock. Harry Cohn, Me Too villain, not the whole story. Very weird, in fact. Or is it weird? I don't know. But he seems like the caricature would, of course, be that a skirt chaser would be an all-around sexist who just saw women in one kind of way and certainly wasn't being pioneering in placing them in high positions at his studio. But such not the case of Harry Cohn.
No, maybe he's more like a Joss Whedon.
Joss Whedon, Harry Cohn analogy. You heard it first here and probably will never hear it anywhere else.
Now, Cohn, we'll talk about this more as we go along. His business practices were extremely shady. One of the movies that is coming up for us, If You Could Only Cook, this is a really famous thing that Frank Capra talks about in his autobiography. When distributing films in Europe after It Happened One Night, do you know this? Harry Cohn started to try to bill most of Columbia's films as Frank Capra movies. Capra got really, really incensed when he found that people in France were getting Frank Capra's If You Could Only Cook.
I don't know if there's been a book on Harry Cohn.
Oh, I think there has been, but I haven't read it, so I don't
know. He's starting to emerge as a fascinating figure for
me.
Well,
yes, he always has seemed so to me.
But even more now, as we learn more through studying Columbia Pictures. I keep saying we're going to talk about the Jean Arthur character. I keep saying we're going to talk about the Jean Arthur character, and I actually, at one point, started describing her introduction, and then we went way off course. But the introduction...
It's the exact same line, pretty much, that she had used in Whirlpool when questioned by her stepfather about why she's coming in at this time of the morning.
Didn't you say that her biographer said this was the moment when the Jean Arthur character is born?
And I guess they agreed, because they're like, let's have her be born again. And here it's in an office context. She comes in late. The office manager asks her why you're stepping in at this time. And she says, well, it's because I saw fit to step out at 9:30 last night.
So a lot of insouciance there. This character seems like a development on the newspaper woman character from Whirlpool as well. And all of these things seem to be feeding into this Capra character that's going to emerge.
Yeah, she's unflappable. She knows the ways of the world.
She's very swaggering, carefree to a point where she seems like a screwball character.
She's happy to be fired.
Yeah, she just doesn't care about anything, initially.
And Edward G. Robinson's just mad about her. Calls her Cymbeline, has her picture up on the wall. Robinson is just melting under interrogation, and she's just having a blast.
A lot of this... It's funny because that police interrogation scene, as well as Edward G. Robinson's feint after he mans up for 2.5 seconds and shoots Mannion, both of those things reminded me of Bringing Up Baby. So I wonder if, I mean, this was a big hit. I'm sure Howard Hawks saw it. But yeah, you know, the jail scene where Katharine Hepburn is pretending to be a gun mole.
Can't think of anything else quite like this in a movie that's earlier than 1935. Maybe there is.
So it's like there's little bits of screwball comedy all centered on the Jean Arthur character that want to break out of this movie.
But something is holding it back.
Very much so.
And we don't have to blame John Ford for that. Maybe I'm being too much of an auteurist myself by saying it's John Ford's fault that the screwball doesn't really get to emerge.
Well, we've seen that he can do comedy very well. We've seen it in his work. It's a certain kind of character. The character that he creates at Fox, that he creates with Will Rogers, right? And then he manages to transfer it to Henry Fonda in Young Mr. Lincoln, and that comedy is great.
Yeah, Cracker Barrel philosopher comedy. This is something that John Ford is excellent at conveying, but...
People have suggested that this resembles The Informer, and I don't remember that movie well enough to know. No, not at all.
Well, I don't see it.
Just in that it's a political satire? I mean, the only political satire part in this is the stuff with the police, which was mainly silly.
It was, but of course there is something serious behind it that this is...
Oh, no, the best, actually the best of all. Was
the bank guard.
Yeah, yeah. And that, I'm sure, was Ford. Although it could have also been Swirling and Riskin.
I mean, this guy is very concerned, and rightly so, that he's gonna get shot.
The black bank guard, yes.
Yeah.
I was just wondering how that would play at the time, because now it plays as you're absolutely, like, for a moment, you're absolutely seriously worried that he is going to get massacred by all of these policemen.
Well, we know that they don't care. Right? They don't care who they shoot.
But would that have been hilariously funny at the time to the audience? Or like, nervous laughter? Hysterical laughter? Like,
well, I think there would have been a range of reactions to it, but if you are a standard 1930s white racist, you probably just find it funny.
But that's the moment where it feels like Ford's Will Rogers type satire, right?
That was really good.
Yeah, as well as the scapegoating theme coming back from the beginning of the movie. It's just all this stuff in the middle, with Mannion and Arthur Ferguson Jones. Jones is what they call him.
Jonesy is what everyone calls him. Yeah. Little Jonesy.
All of that stuff. Just take it all out.
The ending is kind of a surprise to me once again, because he doesn't develop, right? He's the same guy, except that he is getting to go on his adventure to Shanghai through this accident. But he hasn't changed, and Jean Arthur doesn't seem to want him to change into a He-Man.
That's why I'm like, the movie that actually thinks about the psychology of this the most is The Nutty Professor. It actually thinks about the woman's psychology in this position.
Right. No, this one doesn't really. I was happy that Eloise and Abelard are going along on the trip.
Yeah. But she, at various points, her character says she wants him to become a He-Man, talks about how Mannion is her ideal type of man.
Yeah, that just rings so false. That just doesn't have anything to do with the Jean Arthur character that will emerge later.
But then also talks about how much Jonesy has going for him, and, you know, and seems to be trying to just take what he has to offer and support him in that a little, in a Mr. Smith goes to Washington kind of way, be the woman behind the man's success, get his writing career going, and then she'd be happy with him, right? That makes more sense than anything else, these little other bits and pieces of her maybe preferring him to become a Mannion type. So everything's in place to make her into an interesting character within this movie and within this relationship, and it's just never developed.
No, the work is not done.
No.
Before we leave the whole town's talking, I wanted to read Ever G. Robinson's paragraph from his autobiography on working with Jean Arthur. Reviewers were handsome in their comments about me in the film, but their raves were really for Jean Arthur, that curious, neurotic actress with so touching and appealing a nature that she really brought a new dimension to the screen. No curly locks was Jean Arthur, hardly pretty by ancient Hollywood standards, with a voice that grated like fresh peppermint. She seemed to me to be living, off and on screen, in a dream world of her own devising. She was whimsical without being silly, unique without being nutty, a theatrical personality who was an untheatrical person. She was a delight to work with and to know.
Yeah, so Edward G. Robinson was actually a very cultured man, so it's not surprising that he was writing that lovely prose about Jean Arthur.
Yeah, that's what you always read about Edward G. Robinson. Had this incredible art collection. He was nothing like his gangster characters.
He spoke multiple languages.
Yeah, and appreciated working with Jean Arthur.
There you go. If what he's saying is accurately remembered, despite the fact that she has no character, just the fact that she's allowed to act like her established Jean Arthur type in this movie, even briefly, must have made an impact.
Absolutely. Now, I think Party Wire serves her a lot better.
But Columbia's doing a really good job with finding a persona for her really fast now that she's come back from the theater and has signed with them.
That's going to be the story for the next little while. Now, 1935 was an incredibly busy year for Jean Arthur. She made 6 movies at Columbia in that period, and we're going to be seeing them all. This is all before she worked with Frank Capra. Hardy Wire is her first real starring vehicle.
I think the most precious thing in life, she's definitely the star of that. It's a B movie, though.
We could definitely say that, but they're really pushing her onward with this role. I think, you know, the most recognizable Jean Arthur performance so far that we've seen.
So Party Wire was a very good movie.
I really liked it, and I hadn't seen it before.
It was directed by Erle C. Kenton, best known for
Island of Lost Souls,
a very different movie.
He also made a lot of Frankenstein movies later on.
I guess he moved to Universal. Island of Lost Souls at Paramount was 1932.
Search for Beauty, that's a crazy movie.
Oh, so yeah, so now it looks like he went from Paramount to Columbia.
So this is an era of his career I don't know, but we're going to be watching The Public Menace next Jean Arthur episode. So 2 Kenton Arthur films.
And then, yes, goes on to Universal. So mainly known for directing B movies, but this feels like an A movie for Columbia.
Oh, absolutely. And again, they surround her with a lot of good character actors. Her leading man is Victor Jory, who's an excellent actor, but obviously not a star performer.
Yeah, that face. He ended up getting cast as a villain because of his face.
Exactly. But we've seen him before, and I think that you agreed with me when we watched The Devil's in Love that he was amazing in that movie, the Dieterle film. Do you recall it? The French Foreign Legion movie?
Only very faintly, but I'm sure you're correct that I enjoyed it.
Oh, it's so good. And I think he's probably best known for playing the Shadow on the radio, but he appeared in movie after movie for decades. And I guess he's quite memorable in a nasty way from Gone with the Wind.
So our screenwriters here are Ethel Hill, Columbia Stalwart, who we talked about last time, and John Howard Lawson.
One of the preeminent left-wing screenwriters in Hollywood.
Fascinating. So he did smash up Story of a Woman, apparently.
A big writer throughout the 30s and 40s, but my main knowledge about him comes from the Screenwriter Guild and Union Wars, right? Because he was basically the leader of the leftist screenwriters in Hollywood.
And
a flashpoint for blacklist efforts.
He did Algiers.
Earthbound is an interesting movie.
Oh, I forgot to mention some of the things that Viola Lawrence edited. We said she was the head editor.
The Carl Theodore Dreyer.
Probably they made too many films for her to edit all of them. But here's some famous films she ended up editing. Well, for one thing, she's probably despised in auteur circles because she edited Lady from Shanghai and thought, paraphrasing, but thought that what Orson Welles turned in was a pile of shit. Just incomprehensible as a Hollywood movie.
A Hall of Mirrors.
She edited Only Angels Have Wings and In a Lonely Place.
Okay, two of the biggest biggest Columbia films.
You know, in addition to Lady from Shanghai, those are the ones that are really jumping out at me. So, I mean, probably she was given a lot of prestige pictures. She also, here's another famous thing that she did, that she got involved in. She, which might also make her hated by auteurists, along with Gloria Swanson and Greg Toland, she directed the alternate ending to Queen Kelly after von Stroheim was fired.
Brought in by Joseph Kennedy to do that. So she fixed up a Stroheim film and an Orson Welles film. Yeah, she would definitely be despised by auteurs.
Public enemy number one.
So let's talk about Party Wire.
Okay.
This is a small town America film.
It's also kind of a Children's Hour story.
Yeah, definitely. Which was a very popular Broadway play at exactly this time. It's a very scathing portrait of middle America with no real redeeming values discerned. It's not like people have some rough edges, but really they're great. No, they're pretty nasty from beginning to end.
We should probably talk about the novelist who wrote the novel it was based on, Bruce Manning. He was also a screenwriter. Here's some things that he was involved in that we've covered on the podcast. 100 Men and a Girl.
Right.
He's one of three screenwriters on that. That was actually a movie that's perfect in its genre, which is comedy.
Yeah. Well, he wrote Appointment for Love.
Yeah. You liked that one a lot too. We both did. That was for Margaret Sullivan. He was one of two screenwriters on that. So yeah, putting in some good work there. Comedy specialist, it seems like. At least one of the things he was doing. And certainly this movie has comedic aspects.
Oh, sure. Well, it seems like a pretty straight up comedy until the last act.
Yeah. The details of this small town are very thoroughly depicted. This movie does not stint on drawing the picture. And I'm thinking particularly there of the Rotary Club scene, yeah. Where more detail, like you just understand so much about the town from that. It's just such a brief scene, but just so much effort has been put into depicting the men and their environment. That just really impressed me about the movie, being so sneakily thorough.
Yeah, and very critical.
Yeah.
Absolutely no sentimentality reserved for the good people of Middle America.
So you say Lawson was a big lefty, because that's very interesting in terms of how this...
Well, I'm pretty sure he was a member of the Communist Party, yeah.
How this confrontation between labor and capital shakes out near the end of the movie is fascinating.
Definitely talk about that when we get there. We'll set it up. Here, it's a sleepy town somewhere in Middle America. Everyone is perking up because, you know, the heir to the great big dairy concern in the area is coming home, at least for a little while. Walter Brennan is the one that leads us into the film. He is a telegraph operator, gets the news, and we get to see how the communications networks function in this town. He calls home to tell his mom about this. Everyone else is listening in. That's the whole conceit of the film. The party wire creates a whole lot of extra problems. There's bad enough when people just gossiped without technology amplifying everything.
Yeah,
imagine what this film would make of social media.
I was just going to say, yeah, particularly Twitter.
And everyone is very excited because there's a chance to possibly get a hold of that fortune. If you've got a marriageable daughter, get her out there to meet Victor Jory when he arrives at the train station.
Well, this is a ancient comedy theme.
We meet a lot of the town elites and aspiring elite. You know, even the people who are running things want to get richer, so they are currying favor with the biggest family in town.
Yeah, they're like the Paytons.
That's right, that's right. And of course, Jean Arthur and her dad, played by the great Charlie Grapewin, they are sideline observers to all of this. They have no interest in these kinds of shoddy politics and social climbing. And of course, for that reason, Victor Jory likes them the best.
Yeah, I don't know how they have their money.
Well, they probably don't have very much.
They look pretty middle class to me, and she can apparently get along without a job.
Right. Well, that was not that uncommon at the time. If you owned your own house and it was paid for...
Yeah, I mean, that's what I'm thinking of. It's hard for us to understand that now, although you can still sort of do that in some small towns still.
Yeah, of course, of course. So you don't have any serious overhead. You don't have any monthly payments, so you just have to pay for food and that's about it. Sure, there's a lot of space for houses out there, so they're not going to cost you an arm and a leg.
But the point is there not anybody.
No, exactly. Everyone ignores them or would like to ignore them, and they get increasingly upset when they realize that if Jory is going to stay, and it's his idea that he doesn't have any interest in doing that, once he does start to reconsider, it's only because he's interested in Jean Arthur.
Yeah, so what is Jean Arthur like in this movie? Because this is something we haven't seen her remotely do before.
No, but it's something that seems so familiar. This just seems like right in the center, right in her wheelhouse.
Well, I don't know, maybe like a combination of this and what she's doing in The Whole Town's Talking.
This is not what she does in her most interesting films, but it's something that we will see her do quite a lot. She's playing a character fairly similar in a lot of ways to the character that she plays in Talk of the Town.
Mm-hmm.
She's kind of irreverent, but not a complete wild card like she is in some of the Capra movies. She is a figure of knowingness, but also of innocence in a way. You can trust her motives, and you can also trust her to have a better understanding of the social context and cues than most people.
Well, she doesn't really figure out what's going on here for a long time, though. She's definitely not in the knowing position in this movie.
I think she is. She doesn't know exactly what's happening to her, but she knows what she's up against, right? She's not surprised that she's fired from the bank. It's true she attributes it to slightly different reasons than the actual cause, but they're all related.
It takes so long for her to even advance a reason for what's happening to her that it's made me start wondering if in the story this is based on the woman was in fact pregnant.
Could
but
be.
As with Bachelor Mother, it's almost done better if she's not. But I don't know. Small town gossip couldn't really be the theme of a movie where
it's just true.
Where it's just true.
Well, it could
be. That's why it's a children's hour type thing. But in the children's hour, it does turn out to maybe be true or partially true in the end.
Right, exactly.
Have some truth to it, anyhow. Here it's just completely untrue.
She's not right at the epistemological center of the film the way she is with the Capra movies a lot of the time. But she is someone who has a lot more perspective on the town than just about anyone else. And in that, I guess she's matched by Victor Jory to some extent, and that's why they make a good couple.
Well, yeah, that is interesting. I was just going to say that she's so naturalistic.
Yes.
In this movie. Maybe that's all the more notable because she is playing a character who is extreme in a certain way. You know, who is so far outside of this social milieu.
Yeah, she's not the girl next door.
Living with this broken down, alcoholic, completely disreputable father.
Yeah, who's been planning to paint the barn for 7 years at least, because that's what he was doing when Victor Jory left the town to go to Europe and study.
And yet she makes this character who is in this extreme position just seem very grounded and reasonable. You have to be able to just completely like and trust this character or the movie's not going to work.
That's right. In that sense, she's not so dissimilar from the character she plays in You Can't Take It With You.
Yeah, there's more disgust in the Capra movie, but in her complete removal from milieu that she moves within, there's a similarity to Mr. Smith Goes to Washington.
Yeah, so she works at the bank, and we've had several bank teller heroes in our podcast so far, and we'll have more as we go along.
Definitely here as well, you need to be respectable to work in a small town bank.
You cannot be too cautious, as Mr. Twerk would say.
The movie keeps almost falling into the trap of blaming everything that happens on gossiping women, but
no, there's more to it.
But manages to throw enough blame around in general that it doesn't just stick to that. But the general idea is that the women police the sexuality of other women and order their husbands to follow suit.
Yeah, and we've seen that in other films.
Moment in The Sisters, where it's actually the sympathetic characters doing that, and
we were
a little troubled by that.
As we should have been. Probably the person who emerges as the most vile, though, is the awful laughing baboon of a son. I'm almost positive, I didn't look it up, I feel like that's the same actor that plays the goonish son of Bela Bondi in Street Scene. So yeah, we looked it up. It is Matt McHugh. Just a hateful man.
But this is a character who's slept with half the women in the town of all ages?
Pushed that fucking baby cart up to her house? He's the worst. Yeah, I mean,
he gets the last line, too.
Yeah, he does.
So the structure of the story is Talk starts this whole scapegoating snowball, and then more talk ends it, and then we end on more talk.
That's right. It's not actually going to solve anything. the interventions that we've seen in this film. The town is just as small-minded and nasty as ever.
And salacious.
Oh, well, absolutely. They need that.
I mean, all they're really doing here is being a bunch of Henry James characters, except in a small town.
Yeah, and trying to actually make life miserable for everyone else.
Right, rather than just gain sexual knowledge in the abstract.
If they were just speculating and writing fan fiction, let's say, it would be a different matter. But no, they are pushing prams up to someone's house and getting them fired.
Right.
These are bad people. Now, Victor Jory, it's very interesting what they do with that character, right? Because he's just so far removed from all of this. He had no intention of sticking around for more than a few days. He's just there to see his aunt, his ailing aunt, and then he's planning to take off again. He doesn't want to run the business. He just wants to keep reaping the rewards, traveling the world, enjoying himself. And when he does start to take an interest in the area of his birth, it's because of Jean Arthur.
And think about the fact that the first time we've seen her as a love interest was in the Edward G. Robinson movie, and it's as a love interest to Edward G. Robinson, who usually doesn't get those, although he will with Miriam Hopkins in just his next movie.
Well, yeah, but he doesn't get her. She ditches him for Joel McRae, which probably most women would do.
Yes, at a pretty low rung of love interest by her last movie. Here in Party Wire, however, suddenly she's playing a character who, you know, it's actually a kind of Elizabeth Bennet type character. Where you can easily imagine any man with common sense falling in love with her.
That's right. Their courtship, it's nice. They don't have to devote much to it. They just let that happen, and it's sort of a solid part of the story that they're in love and they're going to get married.
You know, there's someone who could have played Elizabeth Bennet and I would have been happy. Jean Arthur.
I would have liked that too, but I think Greer Garson is amazing in that movie, but we will have to come to that one day when we really fight it out over the Jane Austen adaptation.
Well, I guess maybe we don't need to see Jean Arthur with a British accent, so she might as well just have her Capra movies instead.
Yeah, I think so. But I would have gone to see Jean Arthur in Pride and Prejudice for sure. They devote just as much time or maybe more to her relationship with her dad, Charlie Grapewin. It feels a little bit rote for a lot of it, but it really fools you.
It does. I was going to say, and I guess this is by design, for a lot of the first part of the movie, I kept thinking the love story was the plot and wondering why are we devoting so much time to this very basic comedy about this old man who drinks too much. Like, just over and over and over again, the same joke. It was very irritating. But then, obviously, there's a huge payoff for that at the end.
It lulls you into its rhythms, and then you get a real left turn that I found jarring in a great way.
The father, because of his failing, his alcoholism, is the one who starts this gossip.
Yeah, he overreacts. It's an amazing scene, actually.
And this is a great actor.
Yeah, Charlie Grapewin. He's finished off all of his contraband applejack that he's snuck into a cough syrup bottle. I just loved all the scenes. He's just lying there reading the Saturday Evening Post. This is not what I picture most hardcore alcoholics doing, but that's what this guy does. Reads the glossy magazines and drinks constantly, and he's so irritated that she won't go to bed so he can get more alcohol that he totally overreacts to a math problem that she's dealing with, an accounting problem. I found that really fascinating too, that she's doing all the accounts for the church. We don't see anything of the church though, which is interesting. We just see that she is pitching in by, and of course the church in a town like that would have a lot of different functions, right? It would be standing in for a lot of the things that government does in a more normal society. Helping out as an administrator for the church would be something that you might do whether you're religiously inclined or not.
Yeah, of course.
So she's trying to locate, where did the 6250 go? Charlie Grapewin just is like, well, forget about looking for it. I know what happened to it. That guy that is in love with you and is leaving town because you've chosen Victor Jory over him, he's absconding with the funds. I'm going to shoot my mouth off.
I'm going to shoot him.
If he doesn't give a good reason.
Here's a real American for you. Moonshine alcoholic, got a gun in hand, and he's going to threaten to use it anyhow.
So he says a few choice words over the phone that are easily misinterpreted by the salaciously minded, and the plot spins out from there. there. But again, it all happens because he's drunk already. He wants to get more drunk and she won't go to bed and leave him with his jug.
The whole scenario is a plot worthy of Preston Sturges, but he would do it in such a stylized way. So it's interesting to see a movie do this with such a high degree of naturalism.
And of course, building on that, if we follow the Grapewind character's through line, you know, he is a very supportive dad. He's excited that she's finally met someone worthy of her. He's all for their getting married.
And this Victor Joy has always been interested in this family.
Right.
He's always been interested in the dad. He's sympathetic to these broken down bohemians because he, in his wealth and position, is also above the whole middle belt of the town.
That's right. They have the perspective. They get to the bottom of the accounting problem. There was nothing really there. It was just a forgotten ledger entry. When Grapewind goes out there and tracks down the real reason, how the gossip got started, and realizes that the person he wants to shoot is himself, he actually says it in those words. But then he follows through on it, which you don't expect in a movie like this, right? All of a sudden, take a serious turn into pathos.
Yeah, unless it's like Ernst Lubitsch doing Shop Around the Corner.
Yeah.
That's a totally shocking comedy. But here's Mr. Director Nobody working from, you know, some good screenplay, some good source material.
It's got some aspects that I find quite similar to Alice Adams in a way.
Yeah, where...
Which is about...
Where Charlie Grapewind also appears.
Charlie Grapewind in that one plays the factory owner who feels betrayed by Fred Stone's character, the dad, the broken down dad in that movie.
Right.
And they have a confrontation, and he also helps to resolve things after a talk with Katharine Hepburn. But anyway, that movie, so much of it is about a daughter and father in a small town, in a very boorish small town as well.
Now look at the contrast between Jean Arthur and Katharine Hepburn there. Katharine Hepburn in that movie, just so self-conscious and so yearning and so ambitious, right? Just completely, nearly at a pitch of hysteria the entire time. And then Jean Arthur, and all of the stuff is happening to her, and she's angry and she's emotional, but there's also this calm serenity about her.
Yeah, she's a very zen presence in films, despite her well-known, well-publicized frantic nature when getting prepared for roles and waiting for the camera to shoot. I mean, none of that comes across.
Yeah, there's very little visible neurosis, unlike, say, Jennifer Jones, where their neuroticism is in the performance and it's interesting. So then the next most interesting part of the movie. Well, I mean, there's this whole business about Victor Joy trying to transfer his account to another bank and the tedious process that this entails.
Yeah, and it brings the Rotarians in, which you liked. I like that scene a lot too. Great shorthand for just small-minded babbitry, right? Sinclair Lewis America.
Yeah, the attention to detail in that scene just knocked me out. Then this is conflicting with, well, this is happening concurrently with Charlie Grapewind going to the barber shop and trying to find the guilty man responsible, and then having his Oedipus Rex moment when he realizes it's him.
That's right. That's right.
He's going to go gouge his eyes out now. So yeah, this is just whoever the hell is responsible for this. I don't know if it's Bruce Manning or Ethel Hill and John Howard Lawson, but this, as opposed to the whole town's talking, is a perfectly made screenplay. I wonder if it is all there in the novel because of the perfection of the structure of 100 Men and a Girl that I remarked on when we did that movie.
Well, we should obviously do some kind of special subject on Bruce Manning so we can find out. I'm sure the book is available somehow.
And then, yeah, so the next most remarkable scene is the labor capital confrontation in the town hall. Is this his aunt, Victor Joy's aunt?
Yeah, well, she's the head of the concern, right? She's been running the business. Victor Joy nominally owns it, I guess, because he's the only living son of his dad, but he hasn't been doing anything for this dairy. She wants him to take it over because she's 68 and she's tired. She hasn't been able to get out of bed in 15 years, but she's been running the biggest business in the 3-county area anyway.
And
right?
She also still has lots of time to listen in on the party line.
Sure. Yeah, she's part of this, although she's always shown to have more sense than the other people.
But she does buy this story.
She does.
Against Jean Arthur.
Yeah, she does. It's really interesting interesting because the movie gives you this perfect vengeance and then undercuts it and makes you think about the power that capitalists have. It's really quite an ingenious device here because we hate these people.
Yep.
We hate them all. We want, and we're like, oh my God, it's amazing. Victor Jory has the power to punish all of them.
He's like Superman.
Because, or like Batman, more like it, right? Because he's a millionaire who can just mete out vengeance to anyone he decides deserves it. And she says, no, you can't do that. And she has to intervene to cut short his intervention.
Yes, but the moment she intervenes is when she realizes that he might get lynched. There looks like there might be a lynching of a capitalist in this town. That's what's fascinating.
Yeah, well, and it probably would have been deserved as well, right?
Because absolutely.
He's gonna throw 300 people out of work, and we know that most of those people have nothing to do with any of the gossiping that we've seen, because it's mostly middle-class people that don't work for the mill, and he's gonna exact justice upon the proletariat for no reason here, basically, just to show everyone what he can do. Now, more than anything, he wants to teach the bankers a lesson, right?
Right.
That's why he's switching his payroll to a different bank, and the bank did fire Jean Arthur, and he's like, well, I'm gonna get them for that. But there's so much collateral damage there that...
Well, he wants to destroy the town. He's personified the town as being evil.
And it is evil, right? But still, these are people. And that's the ultimate...
Well, the town as a mob is evil. Yes, that's the point.
Yeah.
But they're also people who aren't just a mob. It's like Twitter, again.
Exactly.
People are people, and then they're also a mob sometimes.
Just because people are stupid and evil doesn't mean that they shouldn't be allowed to live. They need jobs, too. You can't just cancel everybody. And that seems to be where this movie comes down, right? He has responsibilities to the people that work for him that go beyond his personal whims.
Yeah, his revenge on behalf of his girlfriend.
That's right. And that's where they come down. They basically put everything back the way it was. Sure, he got a chance to yell at people a little bit in a town hall.
Well, what happens is that the aunt gets wheeled down there and she decides to expose the peccadilloes of everybody in the town in front of everybody else. So it's kind of like the idea of talk, gossip, being bad when it's done behind people's backs. But if you get it all out in the open, maybe there can be some kind of cathartic effect.
Yeah, well, and everyone already knows it anyway.
Yeah,
right?
But they just don't say it.
It's like, you know, naming names of people that everyone already knew, right? But that's exactly what she's doing here. She's saying, well, I could talk about how Walter Brennan was a bootlegger, but you all know it because we've all been buying liquor from him this whole time.
Yeah, and it's a certain context in which it's not said. There's, you know, it's Henry James again. There's this polite maintenance of manners and pretense that everybody is respectable when we're all together in a public setting.
Yeah, and here it does recall Capra a little bit, right? Although mostly Capra movies that are still to come. But Miracle Woman, I guess, is sort of an analogy, although the aunt is not breathing fire the way Barbara Stanwyck is when she calls out everyone in the congregation.
No, she's just ribbing them.
It has more in common with Gary Cooper once he starts talking again in Mr. Deeds, when he identifies all the tics of all of the people in the courtroom,
sure.
Right? He's being accused of being crazy, and he's like, well, if I'm crazy, then what about this person who fills in all their O's this way, and this person that does this, and this person that does this, right?
Sure.
So at the end of the day, basically all of them are exposed as hypocrites.
But it does, like, the things that are talked about in this scene shouldn't, again, like we were talking about in our last episode with Borzage's Strange Cargo, you shouldn't be able to say the things that are said there in a code movie.
Well, the code, obviously, again, it's not as far-reaching as it's made out to be.
Like, this is basically Twin Peaks, the things that people are getting up to in this town.
Pretty much, yeah. Matt McHugh, Burt West, yeah, he's been having trysts with every young lady in town.
No, not just young ladies, it's pointed out.
Oh, that's true. Just anyone.
Yeah.
Anyone that'll take him up on it. And he wanted Victor Jory to go on a party with him as well.
On a joyride.
And the net effect of all of this is just to reset everything to zero. So Jean Arthur is able to marry Victor Jory, nothing else changes.
Like, that part is, like, halfway to Billy Wilder's Kiss Me Stupid, his antics.
Yeah, I would say so.
The movie really joins in a long Hollywood tradition of small-town satire and can hold its head up high.
It should be much better known than it is. I can't believe I've never seen it until now.
It can stand alongside, I don't know in terms of sheer movie making, but for the story it's telling, it can stand, and the way it tells it, it can stand alongside Miracle of Morgan's Creek and Kiss Me Stupid.
And Charlie Grapewin really unexpectedly tears your heart out.
Yeah, the way his character is treated is maybe the most tonally interesting thing that this comedy does, because you are just meant to see him as this adorable, harmless eccentric. But then by the end, the full weight of the self-neglect that he has practiced is made clear.
Yeah, and there's just so much. It speaks volumes about why he drinks every day, right? It's obviously a catch-22. He's made himself into some kind of an outcast. He's made his daughter's life more and more difficult with every passing year, and I'm sure that keeps him reaching for the next glass of Applejack, because there's no other reason he should be so depressed. It's gotta be that he's gotten out of sync with the town, and he knows that it's affecting her chance for happiness as well. Yeah,
it's just a use of comic tropes that is so incredibly rich in its implications, and then these perfect actors being found to enact them.
Yeah, and again, this is not just plucked off Columbia's roster, because they don't have anybody except basically Jean Arthur. So they have to borrow all of these people every time. And in some ways, that it's hard to say whether that benefits or harms. It's hard for me to say that it's a benefit when you compare to Warner Brothers, which just has this amazing, amazing batch of people they can call on continuously. But in a lot of, you know, it probably avoids any miscast character actors, because you don't have to just use whoever's around. You go and borrow whoever's right for each part.
That reminds me, I forgot to mention when we were doing the whole town's talking, I was so pleased that I have now, because you had already done this, but I have now watched enough movies from the 30s and 40s for this podcast, particularly the 30s, that I've now been able to identify more than once the professional fat lady actor from The Shop Around the Corner, who is excellent anytime she appears in a film, who gets a couple of lines here in The Whole Town's Talking.
Well, she was practically the only thing we liked about The Moon's Our Home.
Yeah, exactly. Let me get her name again. Plump woman, uncredited, according to IMDb, in Shop Around the Corner. Grace Hale, who played plump woman, often uncredited, in an enormous number of movies. And we're now starting to be able to identify her when she shows up. I want to give a little cheer every time she does.
Yeah, she was good here too.
So yeah, I guess that's it for Party Wire.
Yeah, I'm really enjoying these early Jean Arthurs, so many of which I have not seen. Soon enough, we'll be getting into, you know, the real glory years. But the stuff is fascinating, and Party Wire is a real gem, I think.
Yeah, for sure.
Fear and movie going in Toronto, at least.
Well, this was a crazy one.
So this month, we are going to see Bikini Kill, unless it gets cancelled by COVID again.
And Rage Against the Machine in the same week.
Yes, separated by 2 days. These tickets were bought in 2019, but they're finally coming home to roost.
These are Dave's choices. I can't credit myself with them.
But as luck would have it, if you know Bikini Kill at all, you may have perused YouTube at one point or another and watched the video of Rebel Girl, one of their most famous songs, which is set to a communist ballet.
Specifically a cultural revolution.
Right before the cultural revolution, yeah. Turns out that is a ballet based on the same story, the Red Detachment of Women, that was told by this film that we saw yesterday. And I wasn't sure which we were going to get, really. Like, I just saw it on the list and I was like, well, we have to go see it. I thought maybe we would be seeing the ballet, but no, this is a gritty war story propaganda film.
Yeah.
About the first stirrings of a women's revolutionary army in Hainan, which is an island, the southernmost part of China. It's an island right off the coast that's kind of south of Hanoi, so tropical. And it's about one woman and the friends that she makes along the way, who is freed from slavery, signs on for Mao's revolution.
Apparently the Red Detachment of Women in reality lasted 500 days.
Okay. And was it in Hainan?
Doesn't say, but I assume so. I'm just looking at the Wikipedia page here. It was broken up by Kuomintang troops. Is that what we see in the movie?
Chiang Kai-shek, yeah. The nationalist.
Right. Some of the women died, some were captured, most returned to civilian life. Some of whom fell victim to the Cultural Revolution later because they weren't politically correct enough, as did practically every human being during that period.
This film is made in 1961, and the reason for it, because it is a propaganda film, is to emphasize the Maoist government's commitment to equalizing relations between the sexes. This was a very prominent feature of the communist reforms. They abolished concubinage. Women were being asked to contribute to society in the same way that a male proletarian would, or a male peasant.
Right, so reading this Wikipedia page, which is interestingly nuanced on the whole Maoist question, definitely not anti-communist propaganda or communist propaganda, talks about how this version of feminism has been subsequently criticized as gender eraser because it just is saying that women should be more like men, which is not unlike, like, real serious Western feminism. You know, Simone de Beauvoir, it's basically the same idea. Women should be like men. Men are the gender that is actually humanity. Women are just like a mutilated form of that, haven't been allowed to fully flourish.
Well, you know, I really feel like this movie does that.
No, I was just, that's why, yeah. I brought it up, because I was going to say, no, the movie's actually quite careful to show the women forming bonds together, being girlish together. One woman has a baby. You know, the movie's quite careful about showing that these are still women, but that the women can do the job of the men.
And they have animosity.
Oh yeah, and they're fucking angry.
Towards the feudal order, right? As their song tells us. I loved this movie. I found it amazing to watch. Mm. I was very moved by it. I thought the performance was tremendous.
The performance was very good.
All the performances were great. The music was amazing.
I mean, there wasn't, like, a ton of psychological complexity to hold the interest.
I think there was quite a bit, right?
It was a sheer melodrama framework.
A lot more thoughtful than I was expecting it to be.
Maybe... I was expecting it to be very campy, and it wasn't. It was definitely not campy, but it was very, very stylized, and yeah, it's propaganda.
It is propaganda, but propaganda that seems to really be thinking through. You know, it's not expecting audience to be blank slates. I mean, it's really saying, like, okay, we know you've got objections here, let's think about this.
Every 10 minutes somebody was learning a communist lesson, though. That it was a little bit much.
I understand that, but it was done in a really amiable way, I thought, much more than I would have expected.
Well, it wasn't done in an amiable way in reality.
I'm not saying anything about the reality. I'm saying the way the movie approaches its audience was a lot more engaging than I thought it would be. It wasn't just barking dogma at you.
No, it was being persuasive in its conversion tactics.
You're really good at enlightening people.
Well, I was fascinated by what appeared to be, because I'd never thought about this before, an appropriation of Buddhism by Maoism. Discussion of enlightenment. You're really woke.
Yeah, you use whatever is available to you. Whatever the culture already offers. And this movie does also foreground one of the real difficulties of applying Marxist thought in a Chinese context and also in a Russian context, which is that they're pretty explicit. They're trying to overthrow a feudal order. They're really doing the work of a bourgeois revolution, but they want to skip it.
They're calling themselves proletarians, but they're actually slaves, so that really stands out.
Well, she's a slave anyway. A lot of the other people are peasants, and our main male hero is a proletarian. But he's really the only one we meet.
Well, the things that I reflected on, like, the movie didn't engage me that much as a movie, although it was definitely very dynamic, the filmmaking, and yes, the central performance was very good. But the things that made me reflect on were this idea that, you know, the two major communist revolutions of that period had nothing to do with Marxism whatsoever. They were actually attempts at
doing what the French Revolution did, overthrow the Ancien Régime.
Well, completely modernizing feudal societies in a very brief period of time, and that's why things went completely fucking insane and everybody lost their minds.
A difficult situation. Now, one thing that I think is certain is that something had to change there.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, I don't know, I think we've talked about this in the podcast before. Actual revolutions aren't something that you hope are going to happen. They're things that happen when things are so bad that they happen. But yeah, so that whole part of things is a total total mess. And then the other thing it made me think about in terms of narrative and storytelling is this fascinating conflict between, for any kind of story, not just a Western story, for any kind of story, you need an individualistic main character, and how this character whose story we're following is trying to be that individualistic hero and keeps running up against the demands of communism, right? Of really working as part of a collective, because the individual is not going to, as the movie keeps saying, and it's correct, the individual is not going to be able to accomplish revolution or cultural change.
When you look at a map of China, it makes it pretty clear.
Oh, that was a great moment, yeah. You're so good at enlightening people.
Yeah, I really like that.
This is a big country. You think you're really going to liberate it by yourself?
Hiding in the bushes, shooting at one vampire? No.
But it's interesting because she keeps failing at the lesson for a long time, right?
Right, because it's a tough lesson to learn. If you've been
beaten
and whipped and your father's been killed by this guy, you want to kill him. Right.
Well, what's so interesting about this as sort of meta commentary on the narrative process is that if you made a story that actually reflected communist values, made a story about a collective, it would be really boring, right? You have to have the individualistic hero. You have to have a story that you're following, person whose story you're following.
The way they did it is to show us someone who never ceases to be an individual, but learns that there's a time and a place for action and a time and a place for holding back. I loved it. I thought it was really something everyone should see.
Well, he made another movie after this. He made a few movies. Apparently, his parents committed suicide. Okay, so the filmmaker is Zi Jin. Apparently, his parents committed suicide because they were pretty stressed out by the Cultural Revolution. And he made a movie that I thought sounded interesting in its description, Two Stage Sisters, 1965, that was criticized because apparently it advocates reconciliation between the classes, even though when I read the plot description, I'm like, doesn't seem like it, but...
Well, that's right when the Cultural Revolution was getting going. And you can see on his filmography, between 65 and 75, there's nothing. So...
Yeah, so this was not made by a particularly politically correct person, which is interesting.
Right, right. It's just a real bravura film.
It's likely that whatever values he's advocating in this film were values he actually held.
Well, how can you disagree with any of them?
Because he was willing to, you know, challenge the strict Maoist party line.
Sure. And, of course, the Maoist party line morphed over time, right? And from 65 to 75, it took a wrong turn. There's no one disputes that, I don't think. In 1961, I don't think anyone realized it was headed that way. So, but yeah, regardless of how things went in the real world, I think everyone should see this film if they get a chance. If it comes to your Cinematheque, you should see it.
Well, I recommend it as a historical curiosity that was not painful to watch.
An absolutely scintillating, rousing experience. The music, you didn't find the music
sure
incredible?
I need that bourgeois psychology, Dave.
Well, I think we got it. We got...
Not enough for me.
It wasn't the primary emphasis, I suppose, but we did get some pretty interesting stuff in there. And I liked the, not quite a love story, but sort of.
Yeah, yeah, that was...
I thought they made a good...
Okay, maybe the problem is that it's primarily an action movie.
Okay.
Maybe that's actually the problem for me. Not that it was a propaganda movie, but that so much of it was action movie.
Okay, that makes sense. Next week, Elise, it's the Hollywood Studios Year by Year, Warner Brothers 1940. It'll be a Betty Davis double feature, The Good Betty and The Bad Betty.
But luckily not in one film, as in The Whole Town's Talking, because that's boring.
That's right. I don't remember A Stolen Life well enough to know exactly how those two Bettys interact. She does play twins in that movie.
Yeah.
But I don't remember it. We'll have to watch that at some point.
You don't remember it because it's probably boring.
It wasn't one of the ones that I rewatched. I think I've only seen it once, and it was like 35 years ago. These movies I have seen a lot. The Letter, directed by William Wyler, and All This and Heaven 2, directed by Anatole Litvak.
That one I don't know as well.
That is one of Betty Davis's most underrated films. I think it should be right at the top of her canon.
Well, we'll see if I agree.
See you then.